historical research. Therefore, we used methodology of world history, and there, and we launched this together with my colleagues in 10 regions of Ukraine. We have worked on several, I'll have a short study slide, but the objectives were basically the following. We attempted to, first of all, give an opportunity to the villages to share their own experience through these conversations, with, through these interviews, but also to document villages' perspectives on their lives under socialism in times and in times of post-socialism, and that is dictated by the methodology of world history. I can say a little bit more to that later if it needs to be. My ambition was also to come up with data which would be eventually built into a searchable online archive. It's something what I do with my oral history project. I spend a lot of time creating those online archival collections, and in addition to trying to write about these works, I truly believe these are the best ways to publicize our work and to use it in teaching as well. And ultimately, of course, the project, apart from just collecting, you know, raw statistical data such as narratives, life histories, and whatnot, of course, the project was to address some conceptual questions, conceptual issues as such, and those can be, of course, taken into different directions depending on how one wants to write about that. But ultimately, as an oral historian who has been working with very many individuals who have interviewed quite a few people, and also as a folklorist and anthropologist, I'm trained now to perceive particular modes, particular discursive features and characteristics in what is being told, and following step. And in light of other oral historians who have been before me and have done a marvelous job pointing out the very valuable history whatsoever, I'm also like them, Lisa Pizzarini, Alexander Portelli, and others. I'm quite interested in, and I've seen it already in data, documenting particular stance, this particular subjectivity, the shared subjectivity, which is which speaks through the walls of documented narratives we have had. The question is whether we can actually talk about this shared subjectivity that sort of a particular mode, discursive mode, the villages have presented us with, given the Ukrainian context, right, given the complexity of Ukrainian history, the complexity of collectivization, historical time frame of it, and so on and so forth. There's definitely some interesting observations can be made there. In terms of what we did, here we are. It was my sabbatical year, and we worked with my colleagues in Ukraine with 10 research centers, specifically in regions where oral history has already made its way. So my desire was to collaborate with colleagues who were already familiar with the methodology of oral history, who already had some followers, had some young students and assistants in place, and that's how we framed it. We've had about 2 coordinators, 14 academics, and each brought into the project 2 more young researchers who actually were conducting interviews themselves. That's why these particular oblasts, that's why these particular regions. Oh, I now regret we don't have, we have the next, but it unfortunately didn't happen because of some didn't happen. So we have gotten to this point now where we have extensive life stories of some 138, close to 140 individuals. On the average, interviews lasted 1 hour and a half. They're shorter interviews, but on the average would be 1 hour and a half. I have interviews which are 5 hours long. And ultimately, 2 hours is the, 1.5 and 2 hours is the average length of those live stories. We have now processed a lot of this data. If you ever dealt with oral history, you probably recognize the challenges there because you need to work with transcripts. And transcripts are time consuming to produce, very expensive, that takes a lot of time. So we are very close to having that, to having near close to 80% or so of transcripts now done. So 98 have been transcribed. And when we gathered for twice in Kyiv, we gathered to elaborate on the methods and principles of our research, we've been very busy doing exactly that. Who exactly we've been interviewing? Why those individuals rather than the other ones? All kinds of questions methodologically speaking were brought up. We ended up interviewing the cohort which was born in 1936-51, and I'll say a few words later about them. And we ended up, of course, interviewing a variety of individuals who spoke about whole slew and whole range of interesting topics concerning, you know, ethnic relations, of course, you know, also the transition itself, because that's what we were focusing on. All kinds of other interesting issues were raised by our respondents, given the methodology of oral history not being prescriptive and dictating particular modes, right, but rather being open-ended. So many professions were, as you can see, occupied. I've been working through this idea of a shared subjectivity, which I should have corrected the word memory here, but that's okay, it's very interrelated, and we will leave it at the moment. And the question which I, as a coordinator of the project, was asking myself, and eventually with the colleagues, we were wondering that exactly the question ourselves too, whose shared subjectivity we're going to document in this particular question, and why that we need to be settling. Why is it important to really have a particular sound? Of course, it's very important. So instead of rather going with several different generations, say those who were in their 60s, in their 40s, in their 20s, maybe it would have been close to three or between two or three generations, we've ended up settling on a particular cohort of Ukrainian villages, which have been born in a particular period of time, have, most importantly, that's not when it's born, but when it came of age. This particular cohort of Ukrainian villages came of age in times where no major cataclysms in the 20th century were cutting into their personal life trajectories. That sort of, in a way, made us go that particular route because it introduced some interesting conceptual possibilities for us to explore, say, the mindset, the subjectivity of a particular generation of sort of farmers who have been shaped by the system, who have lived only in a collective farm. Of course, we have Western Ukrainians, like the different situation there. But nonetheless, those who were born in the age, in this time frame of 1951, even in Western Ukraine, they were young enough children who came of age slightly later in the socialist setting by entering the collective, or rather by being imposed to collectivization as children and living through their parents' experiences rather than through their own. So in the end, having settled on this generation, we've understood that we're going to look actually as a very unique group of the sort of folks who have not been really of interest to many academics so far because they've been lucky. They've never been collectivized. They have never been the Osterbaites, they've never been, well, some of them, again, if you take Western Ukraine, they've been an underground movement, but in principle, there were your stable Soviet farmers all the way through the second part of the 20th century. And even if eventually we were interested in decollectivization as such, if you look at our interviews, you'd be kind of surprised, or maybe you'd be expecting to see that the most of our data actually, because most of our data is focusing on your life in the collective farm, even if we come to document decollectivization. As early historians, we come with the question to our respondents to first respond and describe their lives. Many have chosen to speak at length about their lives, which were shaped by the Soviet system, unfolded in, and in which they become adults, with their families, and so on and so forth. And only later, they have been focusing, or rather reflecting on decollectivization. And interestingly, few volunteered to focus on that topic at length. That was too painful, too close, too dramatic, and also too much life-altering. So this particular cohort, therefore, is what who we worked with. And eventually, when I was looking back at our research, I also reflecting back on how Ukrainian historians in Ukraine operate within the studies on village cultures or in Selyansky. It's very common for my colleagues in Ukraine, historians and otherwise, to, you know, use this wonderful collective noun, Selyansky, or peasantry, and lump everything under it. This is very typical and has been typical and it's still happening. And if you, of course, an anthropologist, a moral historian, or a social scientist for that matter, is you understand that there's more to that just, you know, one bundle of every of a social class than simply one social class as such. So working with these four individuals have, I think, informed us also, or reminded us that we are actually here to undo a little bit of particular discourse, maybe at least in Ukraine, which would allow us to, you know, look at Sedan's group in more complex ways than until now. I have spoken, I've written very little about this project, but what I did write about was focused more on what I call narrative identities and narrative representations of individuals, their own lives. This is something I'd like to briefly come back to, because when you are dealing with this massive data, as an oral historian, as an analyst, you're dealing with narratives first and above all. You're dealing with self-representations, with stories as such. And it becomes your data. It really is what oral historians oftentimes focusing on, and if they are trying to understand the processes of, or interaction between public and private planes of, you know, memory construction, that's your data. So as an oral historian, therefore, we borrow a lot from narrative analysis, from literary studies. I use Bakhtin. I use, for example, in Bakhtinian's analysis, when he works with Greek novels, he pays close attention to the representation of the narrative of the identity of the protagonist. And if, of course, a novel succeeds and presenting us with a transformed figure, like from point A to point B, in real life, of course, of that protagonist, and the novel is effective and successful. But a folkloric model of writing would present us with very different protagonists. Again, as a folklore scholar myself, I studied Duma, I studied other narratives, and I've adopted many real folks, and I've documented many life stories in which people, when they externalize, they are in the conversation, have to reflect upon themselves. They, of course, become externalized to their own identities. And oftentimes, as if this particular project had shown us, they don't present themselves as an evolved protagonist of their life stories. Rather, as oftentimes, it is a character who remains the same throughout the whole entire course line. So, narrative analysis, therefore, gives us these opportunities to perhaps understand real identities as well. So that's why I'm framing it with such rules. So what comes across with these narratives when we work with them as analysts, as readers, interpreters, is the certain presence of certain features. And one most powerful and most telling dimension of any of those narratives is the presence, the dominance, the pivotal presence, really, of work and work ethic in every single self-representation which persons do. Work features is a core identity feature. And in talking about their lives in the times of socialist system of it was built on, the interestingly, something we didn't expect, but interestingly, the folks who responded to ours, were quite good at constructing and projecting their own sense of agency, their own ability to navigate the system. Those fantastic stories how collective farms are, heads of the collective farms are trying to navigate the shortage in supply systems. How, for example, at some point I remember reading a story, a very, very reflective gentleman, the head of the collective farm in Dnipropetrovsk, told me the story how he had to pour the gasoline out into the ground because the center had told him to receive all the gasoline. They've already used up all the milk gallons for it, so they couldn't really now go beyond that. So they had to pour it out in the ground because they have to receive it here. They couldn't say no to that oversupply of gasoline at the time where the neighboring village would be suffering from the shortage of it. So he did put it in the milk gallons to save some for his private traditions. So in addition to, of course, to the heads of the collective art, more educated folks, like agronomists and so on and so forth, folks who were at the lowest echelon of that sort of structure and work as it was organized in collective farm, they were also very able to think of themselves as doers rather than as sufferers. Here you have this interesting, at least from my viewpoint, disjunction, if you wish, between the public discourses when it comes down to describing the Soviet silence, the Soviet peasantry, and the emic perspectives of those who themselves describe themselves to the researchers. So again, something to reconcile between the two perspectives. I think this project can do that. And so to give a couple of examples, there is this very cheerful lady, I apologize for this big quotation, but if you have time, read through that. But in this particular case, this very, very positive, very amazing woman spoke about her, she compared today's to yesterday's. She spoke about how much work, of course, she had did as a kid in the school and what it was like for school children to be members of, to be raised on the collective farm and eventually become members of those. They've been working from very early age as add-ons on these brigade and whatnot. But I always remembered in the most positive, cheerful way. No one was exploiting anybody in her particular case. And she spoke also of how she was complimented on behalf of her heart, well, on behalf of, but because of her strong commitment to work, she was also sent to the university. She got her education there. As she got her high education, came back to the village to work as an agronome. I forgot what to translate it. They are the other specialists, I would suppose, right now. So she is something which, her sense of memory, her sense of her past is driven by these positive memories of socialism. But if we move on, I guess, not incidentally, to Western Ukraine, and we talk to a different individual, the same age, different life context, so equally hardworking individual told me, or they, not me, but the interviewer, very interesting stories about how she would, how she worked and how journalists were mistaken for her. She actually came late at midnight, in the middle of the night, to finish work in the field that was collected on field. The rain was imminent, so she needed to tie up the hay, and the journalists were passing through, and they were all assuming that she was stealing, and meanwhile, she was actually working. So it's also interesting stories, but she remembers her take on work is slightly different than you see this lab. If you listen to the stories and read the narratives, which of course changed here dramatically to fit into our expectations during the presentation, her take on work was very different from the previous commentator. But despite the differences in these perspectives, whether Vera or Sophia's case, we are seeing a dominance of work in the context of their lives. Lots of interesting other observations can be brought up. Of course, gender cuts into the ways how personal subjectivities are shaping around the memories of socialism and post-socialist transition, of course. The social status that people in villages all have, though they were like to conquer somewhere, different status, somewhere less or high, that was featuring. Education shows, of course, or as a dimension, education cuts into the narratives and shapes them very differently as well. But of course, probably not surprising, but at least when you work with this man's data, strikes me, is returning to that shortened or severed genealogical memory. In this particular instance, is very interesting, in which the woman only knows that her grandfather was a blacksmith. It's just because how the villagers were conveying this knowledge to them through the folk, through this hearsay, right? That's what you remember in the village. So I know my father was a blacksmith because people used to say it was hard to find something like him. The memories of collectivization were, or the memories, sorry, of the reflections of individuals' lives in the collective farm were governed by certain, again, narrative principles, by certain principles in post-Soviet nostalgia, especially in the Eastern Ukraine. You can see and hear people bringing in politics and ideology into their reflections. Definitely ideology features. Communists will speak differently than regular members of collective farms of their past. But in the collectivization narratives, we have seen an interesting shift, at least in how people were presenting themselves. Something I wasn't expecting, because in the when we were preparing for this project, we knew we were talking about decolonization. We knew we would be interested in focusing on that. But as we've observed in our second seminar, when we've already been done, when we've done some field work already, we've noticed that it needed prompting, it needed questioning, and people were less hesitant to. It actually was quite a break in self narratives from remembering collective farm to now remembering globalization. Of course, not surprising. But conceptually speaking, some interesting shifts were also happening. One of those shifts, I think I'll be eventually referring to it, but I'll say it now, is this shift from the sense of who a person is, a doer or a receiver of the action passed on or imposed upon him. So this is indeed where we've seen the loss of agency in individuals who are reflecting on decollectivization, where more commonly projecting themselves, actually overwhelmingly projecting themselves as victims of history, as victims of reforms. Again, not surprisingly, I suppose. But a lot of interesting, the project also came up with many, many interesting details as such, concerning specifically the actual happenings in the village. And though I'm not aiming at reconstructing the actual course of decolonization as it unfolds in each and every village, which we've covered with our project, nonetheless, the data really is delivering a lot of interesting information exactly on that topic. And for me, what was of interest is to see how villages are talking about that, because probably you might remember or you have followed up that the redistribution of assets involved redistribution of land and actual collective farm properties. Land was complex, but simple. Land was a little bit more of a different question altogether, because eventually the villages, by the end of the second phase of decolonization, of reforms rather, sorry, they've been finally assigned the pies. They couldn't really, of course, and they still can't, we know the moratorium on sale of land is still on, but they couldn't sell, they could work themselves their land and they could lead it or rent it out. That's still in place in terms of legalities of it. And therefore, parcels and pies as such were, of course, discussed, and lots of commentary was issued vis-a-vis that. But when it came down to the distribution of the assets, that was especially hard work and breaking for the individuals who built those collective farms themselves, because the redistribution of assets of, say, I guess we have it already here, right, meant literally coming together as a group of people, or maybe seeking out to be more adventurous or advantageous, and basically taking apart the buildings, the equipment, and literally physically breaking objects apart and splitting them. So that was very common description in the project when it came down to decollectivization and redistribution of properties. And then, of course, that particular generation had really little understanding what to do with the land and the pies. They've oftentimes taken it as questionable. What am I to do with that? So a lot of interesting observations, of course, would be taken or can be made by looking at this particular data. And I can certainly pick more, but I will start wrapping it up a little bit. The stories which we've recorded certainly are full of detail, which is of interest to just any researcher. In fact, that's probably one of the big positives of the project. But for the analysis of someone like myself, of the Netflix data, there's a few interesting conceptual routes one can take, and I'm still contemplating which ones to take before you will come with your comments. But ultimately, the major observations, also the main observations thus far, by utilizing methodology of history, eventually oral historical narrative analysis, which is actually a beast of its own nowadays, rather than simply narrative analysis. We can document the shift in self-representations and identities from seeing myself as agents to to eventually projecting the oneself as a subject of the post-socialist transition. The project, I believe, also had contributed something to this idea of deconstructing Selyamskoe as a conglomerate of its own and introducing a new perspective on more nuanced experiences some members of the peasantry had gone through. And obviously we've documented quite an ambivalence, quite an unresolved ambivalence towards the peasantry's recent past, though we expected more coherence in narratives about the political position. They were quite disjointed themselves as such. I am going to leave you leave this presentation with just very, very few more questions, which eventually I'd like to explore ultimately on that very conceptual plane of the project. What is that potentially shared subjectivity is that we can identify and talk about? What if the testimonies on depolitization can tell us about the changing memory landscape in Ukraine? Will these stories matter? Because so far, I'm not sure they're part of the memory battles in Ukraine as such. I'm not sure, we'll have to see. And how can those oral narratives inform our understanding of historic change and social experiences of it? Because these experiences of depoliticization in Ukraine have been repeated before elsewhere, and we still have a few other territories in the world where socialism is getting a grip on the world. Maybe there's some lessons to be learned from that project in, say, Cuba. Well, I shouldn't say that. Oh dear, politically incorrect me. All right, I will wrap it up at this point. Thank you very much.